Hi everyone, I'm Janvi and I'm making this lecture series on 12th standard HSC psychology. We have a lot of chapters, the whole portion is new, and that's why I want to give a summary of all the chapters. So because this is a summary, I won't be going too much into depth, so I'm not going to read every line and explain it to you, but I do have a summarization. So if you studied this in your class in college, or if you have studied somewhere else in your tuitions or somewhere, you'll be able to get a gist out of it. So it's best if you studied it somewhere else or even read the chapters first and then you're looking at these summaries. I'll try to go in as much detail as I can, but still, I'll just be having an overlook. So every chapter, say in 10 to 20 minutes is my goal, so that you can have a quick revision before an exam for every chapter. This year, the portion is new as compared to all of these years, which has been in psychology. And I really like the new portion. It's very, very practical. You can use it. It's applicable. I have made some short forms. So we are going to work through the whole, you know, have a summary of that. But it's an interesting portion. I hope that you enjoy this lecture with me, and I'm going to post series of chapters after this too. Okay, beginning with the first chapter, so it's about psychology as a scientific discipline. Psychology is a social science, and so the word science means that there is experimentation. It's not just something like philosophy, which you think about something and you just want to write it down, or it's not literature that it's a novel or a story or something that's in your mind. It has some evidence. So psychology as a scientific discipline, it's an important chapter as a base, because throughout, if you want to pursue psychology in the future, you will be studying this. So it's good that you pay attention to this chapter in particular, because this is something which, whether you want to do clinical psychology, counseling, or any kind of psychology, or even if you don't want to do it, don't want to pursue it, but if you're just studying it through the college, this is going to be useful for everybody. Okay, so the first thing is about what sciences are. Basically, we have physical sciences, biological sciences, and social sciences. So psychology is a social science. Science word comes from the Latin word scientia, which means knowledge. And science is basically the pursuit and application of knowledge and understanding of natural and social world following a systematic methodology based on evidences. So basically, in easy words, it's just a proper systematic method of understanding, having a knowledge of a particular subject, but you also have to have proper evidence for it. You have to have proof for it. Okay. So what makes psychology? So what are the key features of science? And for this, I've made a short form called ROSPE. So ROSPE, ROSPE. Okay. The first one stands for replication, which means you can reproduce the same experiment. For example, if I conduct an experiment today, okay, which is say in 2020 on intelligence, and after 10 years, somebody else wants to further my work. They see that, okay, I've done this much and now I want to take the work ahead. So they should be able to first replicate. Yani, maine jo experiment kiya hai, usko wapas se karna. They are able to redo the experiment, replicate it. That is the first ability. So if I just randomly do something, then it's not easy to replicate it. Like a speech, if I give just randomly, I may not be able to replicate it exactly. I may not be able to replicate everything. But if you see an experiment, laboratory, it has everything which is done very systematically. And that's why you have the ability to reproduce it. So RO stands for objectivity, very important in psychology, because psychology is a topic where we study things like values, beliefs, all of these things, right? So objectivity is important because you have to see things as facts and not just like you want to see them. For example, you want to study the difference between men and women. Now, if you're a woman yourself, just because you want to see that, okay, women are better at this particular thing, you can't, because you want to see it like that. You have to be objective. So you have to see it as a fact. S stands for scientific causality, which means you have to be able to, so ROS, S stands for scientific causality, which means you have to be able to see something in terms of science. You have to establish a cause, you have to establish a cause effect relationship. So your independent variable is a variable which you manipulate on your own. Manipulate ka matlab hai, for example, if I want to study the effect of coffee on anxiety, so independent variable will be coffee because I'm manipulating as in simple words, changing it. So in one group I will keep a lot of coffee, in one group I will keep participants who get no coffee. Okay, so this is the independent variable because I'm adjusting it, I'm testing it, and I'm checking the effect, that is the effect it has on, say, anxiety. So coffee is my independent variable and your anxiety is your dependent variable because it shows the effect. Okay, so scientific causality is important. Just because two things are coexisting, I can't say that ye iske wajah se hua. For example, if somebody's best friend moved to another city and if that person failed in an exam, I just can't say that he failed in an exam because his best friend moved to another country. It could be one of the factors responsible, or it could just be correlated. It may not be the cause. So to establish causes effect, we need to make sure that we are doing an experiment. Another S stands for systematic exploration. So we have to have a sequential procedure. So you can't just conduct a full experiment and then say I will make my hypothesis. Hypothesis ka matlab hai ki you're predicting something. Basically it's a predictive statement that coffee will have an effect in people's anxiety. So that is a hypothesis. But I can't just do the experiment and then make a hypothesis saying, ki, oh, now I did an experiment, now I will say that I had predicted this. You can't. So it has to have a sequence. So that is systematic exploration. The reason why sequence is very important, so that it also helps you replicate, makes it a standard process. Okay. P stands for predictability. Any phenomenon that you study should be, you know, you should be able to predict them. Okay. For example, if you're studying behavior, you should be able to predict that, okay, if I do this, I will be able to predict ki ye change aayega. So if I give more coffee, I will be able to predict that there will be more anxiety. So predictability is important. And empirical evidence, which means that you have to have evidence. You just can't say that, oh, I saw this, that's why I liked it. No, you have to have written proofs. You have to, I've done an experiment of these many people and that's why I can prove that this is what. And say 95 out of 100 people felt more anxious after they had coffee. That's why I have evidence. Okay, and still coffee is not an example for experimentation, but say 95 out of 100 people lost weight after following a particular exercise. So I can say it with evidence that exercises leads to weight loss or a better body. Okay, so you need to have, and the reason why I focused so much on this part was because it's very important. Your fundamentals have to be clear. You need to know each of these, you know, you need to know what you're writing inside also, because probably this year board exams may not be written. Some teachers are saying, who have a lot of experience, who've been board correctors for many years, are saying that probably this year it could be MCQs. We never know. So it's better to understand, and even if it's not MCQs, it's best to have a fundamental understanding of concepts. The next thing is history of psychology as a science. I'm going to go over it very quickly because I've explained this in detail in my lectures. Okay, so psychology comes from a branch of philosophy. So people like Aristotle and all these people spoke about things which were related to psychology, but psychology name was not there at that time, ancient Greeks. So until the 1870s, there was no name. 1879, Wilhelm Wundt was the first person who made the first psychology laboratory, and it was in Germany at University of Leipzig. After that, it was made in US by William James and all of those people. Okay. So that was the official start of psychology as a scientific, separate scientific discipline. Otherwise, it was just a small part of philosophy. Then structuralism emerged. So structuralism basically believes that you can get answers to anything through your senses and conscious study of your conscious experiences. Like, did you feel something? Did you sense something? Did you hear something? So Wilhelm Wundt and Edward Titchener, these were the guys who professed structuralism. Then came functionalism, which believed that, okay, there are a lot of things which you may not consciously perceive, but they still exist. So that is why functionalism came, when James advocated functionalism, and he's called the father of American psychology. He emphasized the study of human consciousness. Now, psychoanalysis emerged, was the next stage. During the World Wars, Sigmund Freud, I have shown a documentary on this in my lectures about how he used to counsel people, and a lot of those problems, which were those hysterical behaviors, these behaviors even if you do any kind of testing, any kind of scans, analysis, there was no report in brain difference, physiological differences that could be made out in these kinds of behavior. Sigmund Freud would do some psychoanalysis and help them come out of it, which meant that he spoke of a thing which is psycho, which means your mind. He spoke about psychoanalysis for the first time and he gave the concept of unconscious mind. He said that everything is in your... So he said we have a conscious mind, like you are consciously aware of some things, and there is an unconscious mind which has all your suppressed desires, because you're not allowed to keep these. Like, for example, everybody, he said that everybody has a sexual desire, okay, that they want to have multiple partners, but you can't go in, come on, you are hungry, you go and tell your mom, I'm hungry, give me food, you know. But when you become a teenager, become young, you don't go and tell your mom, I'm horny, give me a guy. So he said that all of these things, they are, but these desires are there in your mind. They remain suppressed in your unconscious mind. Okay, so that's what Sigmund Freud said. Then behaviorism emerged. So Watson was the person. So behaviorism did not believe in unconscious, because unconscious said a lot of things about childhood. So in childhood, if bad things happen to you, all of those things. The reason I'm saying this is not because you have to write it in the exam. You don't have to write all of that. You just have to write the basics, but you have to remember it. So these behaviorist guys were like, okay, not every psychoanalysis says that everything is related to your childhood. You can do nothing but just talk about it. But behaviorism said, no, we will predict behavior. We will control behavior. So people like Watson and all say that behavior is learned, and you can unlearn and you can teach behavior. You can teach and you can make children do things that you desire. So you reward a good behavior, it will lead to an increased number of that behavior. So behaviorism focused on science. Okay, and this focused on observable behaviors. Then came humanistic psychology. So Carl Rogers, so in behaviorism and all the others, the psychologist used to be like the person who used to control the sessions and all of that. But humanistic psychologists started believing that the client is equally important. Just because he's a client doesn't mean he's lower than you. Doesn't just because he's going through a psychological problem doesn't mean that we are psychologists are greater than them. So humanistic started focusing on the human aspect. He said they were not in favor of, they were contrast to the study of unconscious and determinism. Determinism by behaviorism, which meant that, oh, everything we will control and we will determine your behavior, that kind of a thing. No, they said that every individual has a free will. And they said that everybody will lead to self-actualization. We as psychologists are just supposed to facilitate, just help them be better humans. That's it. We don't control them. We don't control their therapy. We don't advise them. We are not advice givers, or we don't try to control their behavior or change them. We have to just help them change. Okay. Then came, obviously, cognitivism has been growing from a very long time. Cognitivism basically focuses on your brain analysis. So Neisser was this person who is considered as the founders of cognitivism. So they study, either use MRI, PET scans, CAT scans, all of these scans of the brain to understand your brain more in detail. Okay. So this was the history of psychology. Then we come to the research methods in psychology. The first one is experimental method. So experimental method, like we studied the scientific sequence, you know, in the start part. It has to follow a certain method. So like first is you have to identify what the problem is. The problem, for example, is postpartum depression. You're trying to study depression after women give birth. So what is the problem related to that? So you find a problem that, okay, women who live alone are likely to experience postpartum depression. So that's a problem. Then you define a hypothesis. So hypothesis will be women who live alone or loneliness has an effect on postpartum depression. Then you make a design, you study and make an experimental design, you conduct experiment collecting data. So here in this case, you might not be able to exactly make them alone, but you may study women who are alone, or you design an experiment where you're conducting a proper experiment. Like, for example, one experiment was on whether you sleep, this is useful for you, it will help you in your exams also. Whether sleeping for more hours needs, like for example, if you sleep for 3 hours and go for an exam, you don't sleep at all, study all night and go for an exam, or you study for 6 hours, sleep for 6 hours and then go for an exam. So in first case, study for 12 hours, no sleep and go for an exam. Second is study for 9 hours, sleep for 3 hours and then go for an exam. And the third situation is you sleep for 6 hours and study for 6 hours and go for an exam. And you find out, you conduct an experiment that you make some students sleep for, say, only 3 hours, some for 6 hours, and some don't sleep at all, only study. And then you find out the results that who does best. And by the way, research says that people who sleep for 6 hours do much better because your brain can consolidate your information at that time. So you design an experiment, you analyze the data, and then you make conclusions out of it. So that is your experimental method in general. So your important features in experimental method are your objective method, your observations, controlled conditions. So it's not just like, this person is also not sleeping. In a laboratory, you control that this person who is studying is only studying and really not sleeping. In another place, some people might be studying while they are also eating, watching TV. You have to make sure that you're controlling it so you can establish a cause-effect relationship. So sleep causes a better retention of memory. That makes a cause-effect relationship. Okay, you can't just say that sleep hua to it's correlated. No, that's different. You have to find things which are verifiable. Okay. The next thing is your survey method. Okay. Survey method is you take surveys, like you've given a lot of YouTube surveys, predefined. You have to answer certain questions. A lot of people are given these. Check, they can be checklists. Like you give a lot of YouTube surveys also. What kind of videos do you watch? These are surveys, and social psychologists, educational and industrial psychologists use this more often. You can do it via telephone or direct interaction too. Survey method is your predefined group or respondent sample. So your political opinions, everything. The next one is observational method. Okay, observation is omitted for this year, that is 2020-21 batch. Those who are appearing for 21 boards, but I'll still go over it. Observation is basically some things you just can't control experiments. So for example, if you want to study a child, okay, how a child behaves in a certain situation, you can't just put that child in an experiment. The child doesn't know anything. So you have to sit and observe. Observation can be naturalistic and controlled. Naturalistic is in the natural setting. You go to the child's house and observe. Control will be you call the child in a laboratory and observe him. So see, child psychologists, clinical psychologists, social psychologists use this method. And if they do it in a systematic way and all, it gives a good research. Okay. The next one is case study method, which means you take one particular case. For example, narcissistic personality disorder. If there was a case on that, and I study that one case because not many people have that, okay, or some rare diseases or something like that, you take one person and do a proper case study of that. So that is your case study method. It's used a lot by clinical psychologists. Clinical are the ones who are basically dealing with these kinds of mental disorders. So Sigmund Freud and Piaget. Piaget was known for doing a lot of research on cognitive development of children. So he used a lot of case study. You take an in-depth look of that case and speak to their parents, find all kinds of details. It gives you a lot of descriptive and rich information. Okay. The next one is correlational. So this is important. Correlational, basically, you are giving a proper correlational analysis. So, for example, about coffee, whether coffee is correlated with, say, sleep or not, that is something which you study in correlational studies. Okay. So, drinking more coffee, I'm sorry for my drawing, leads to more anxiety. So they are correlated. You can't say because you drank coffee, it was more. It's just correlation that, okay, this person has been drinking more coffee and he's been feeling more anxiety. So correlation means that two things are just coexisting together. They may, but they are not causal. It's not that because of coffee, this is happening, but definitely it is related to it. So now correlation is measured through a correlation coefficient, which is on a continuum between, say, -1, 2, +1, and this one is 0. Zero correlation means it has no relationship at all. There is no relationship at all between. So coffee and anxiety has no relationship at all. So, or for example, cheese and gaining weight has no relation. That would be zero relation. But if you say eating cheese, the more cheese you eat, the more fat you become. That will have a +1 correlation. So perfect one correlation means if you eat the amount of cheese you eat is equal to, say, jitna cheez zyada khaoge utna hi zyada weight badhega. And exactly -1 is the more cheese you eat, it goes in the opposite direction. So more and less. Okay, the same is with, say, anxiety. I'm just going to erase it. So before I give you an example of that, I'm just going to say that, for example, something like 0.3, a correlation is 0.3. Is this bigger or a 0.7. Okay, the answer to that is always see something which is closer to 1 is a greater correlation, because this 0 means ki correlation hai nahi. Negative 1 means strong negative correlation. Negative positive 1 is strong positive correlation, which means that always if you see 0.7 will be more than 0.3. Similarly, minus 0.7 is more than minus 0.3. Okay. Now let's go ahead. Negative correlation. Let's see the example that they've. So basically, a zero correlation makes no significant change at all, and negative correlation means increase in one value is associated with a decrease in others. For example, you increase intake of a particular food product and it leads to a decrease of your weight. Okay, so that's a negative correlation. So say hot water is negatively correlated with fats or weight gain, because when you drink more hot water, you lose more weight. So that's a negative correlation. Okay. The next one is challenges in establishing psychology as a science. So psychology has been doing a lot of experiments, but still it's not a proper science. There are a lot of reasons for this. The first one is it's in the pre-paradigmatic stage, which means that psychology, Kuhn said that it's in the pre-paradigmatic state, which means that psychology did not succeed yet in producing a cumulative body of knowledge. If you understand what cumulative is, cumulative means, for example, you have this one, okay? You have 1, 2, 5. So cumulative ka matlab hota hai 1 plus 2 becomes 3. 3 plus 5 becomes 8. So cumulative matlab, it keeps on adding, and it becomes more. So psychology has not been a cumulative knowledge because, say for example, psychoanalysis, Sigmund Freud studied the human mind in terms of psychoanalysis. When behaviorism came, they did not necessarily take it ahead from where Sigmund Freud stopped. They made a whole different perspective of their study. So not everything, matlab, sometimes you're just studying intelligence in a certain way and then you just end up doing it in a totally different way. So it's not but when it comes to say scientific discovery, like a coil was made, okay, you made a coil. Immediately after the coil, a bulb was made. It helped in the invention of bulb. In fact, electricity came, coil came, bulb came. So, or you understood gravity on top of it. So it's a cumulative science, whereas psychology, that happens in a pure science, but that's not happening in psychology. Okay. And not everybody, all the experts. So for example, behaviorists will not agree with psychoanalysts and psychoanalysts will not agree with behaviorists. So not everybody agrees with the same thing because it's not a cumulative. It has different perspectives and human mind keeps changing, right? The second is issues related to objectivity and validity. So some things are soft research. You use soft research methods like emotions, attitude, leadership, creativity. You just can't directly objectively judge this like you study gravity or a chemical equation. Another one is issues related to predictability and replicability. So you have to be able to predict behavior and understand the causes, but it's not compulsory. Like for example, something might be able to predict a behavior, but there are 100 other things that might predict. So just by teaching a behavior, you can't predict it totally. There are 100 other factors like personality, peers, surrounding, 100 other things which come in the middle. So you can't directly totally predict something. And replicability. So it's not necessary that, for example, if I do an intelligence test ka replication, which an intelligence test which is made in America, I do it in India, not necessary I'll get the same results because there's a lot of cultural factors which make people different. And that means that I won't be exactly be able to replicated. Objectifying humans is another problem which humanistic psychologists focus on. They say that whenever we do experiments, we are objectifying people when it comes to mind. So you hear words like you moron, you see, you hear words like idiot. Actually, these words were first used for denoting IQ. People with a low, below average IQ were called moron, idiot. So these were the levels and categories. But now you see how people use it. They use it as a you're kind of insulting someone. In the same way, now then psychologists change the word to say mentally challenged. So now now friends tell each other, "Tu pagal hai kya? Mentally challenged hai kya? Are you schizophrenic?" People use these words so common. So we are objectifying humans and we're dehumanizing, which is a problem with psychology because it is people will openly say, "I'm diabetic," but if you call someone schizophrenic, it is not a nice thing because people make fun of that. Okay. So that's the reason why it's difficult to establish psychology as a science. The importance of rationality basically is that Aristotle said long time back that anything a man does is in order to be happy. Whether you do, you study, you want to be successful, in the end you want to be happy. So what this thing does, okay, what this thing is showing is rationality is very important. Because if you are irrational, irrational ka matlab hai main hi bura hoon, irrationally thinking, logical nahi soch rahe ho, bas irrationally soch rahe ho, that leads to a lot of negativity. So say if you see people with depression, so that is according to this perspective, people who are with depression have a lot of irrationality in them. So say this guy Stanovic said that rationality includes adaptive reasoning, good judgment and good decision making. Sternberg spoke about practical intelligence, that is then we spoke about emotional intelligence. So basically you're rational, you're not emotion driven, you're not all of these things include in your rationality. Albert Ellis spoke about rational emotive behavior therapy, where he said that people who are irrational tend to turn more towards depression. So he would take those people out by making them think more rationally, because rationally people are psychologically healthy. Okay. Now, understanding self-interest and social interest is an important part of, so we made SUFTS, SUFTS for this, SUFTS. So please go through that. SUFTS means understanding self-interest and social interest. You have to also understand what promotes your healthy behavior, and you also don't have to violate other people's rights. So understanding self-interest ka matlab ye nahi ki mujhe pura din pade rehna pasand hai, so I'm not going to go and work, let my wife earn and everything. No, you have to have self-interest also, but social interest also. Self-direction means you have to take your primary responsibility. You are responsible. A lot of people who say that no, main depression mein isliye hu kyunki mere saath zindagi mein kuch acha hi nahi hua hai. So you have to assume primary responsibility. That's self-direction. I'm going to show you my website of this, on which I've made a quote on this specifically. Another thing is tolerance. So basically willingness to accept behavior and beliefs of others that are different from one's own. You have to be tolerant. You just can't say because this person thinks this way, I hate him. Okay, like because this person is a vegan, I hate him. Because this person is a non-vegetarian. No, you have to be tolerant. Because the more intolerant you are, the more negative you are. Flexibility is, you have to be unbiased. You should be flexible. If I tell you, you not have rigid boundaries. Like some people are so rigid that they want to sleep only in a particular place. They need a particular blanket. These are very compulsive behaviors. Mujhe ye blanket nahi mila to main soonga nahi. I never travel by train. I can't travel in long distance flights. No, you have to be flexible. Rational people are flexible. Self-acceptance, if you want to be happy, it's good to be flexible. Rational self-acceptance and self-responsibility is also something that rational people have. So they accept themselves unconditionally. They don't say, oh, you know, I'm an angry person, I hate myself, this, that. They accept, first you start accepting yourself, you automatically start working towards change. The second one is self-responsibility. They take responsibility for their actions. So Albert Ellis also spoke about rationality and a personal philosophy that helps an individual to attain goals in life and be happy. So that gives an end to our first chapter. I hope that it helps. I'm going to show you my website. So I just made it. So I'm quite excited to show it to you. I'd recorded this whole chapter when I was teaching it in class, but the whole recording did not have sound. So I redid it. That's my website. You can check it out. I'm also going to add 12th standard psychology section in this. So to know more about me, to see, to get more in touch with me, I have a lot of other things also. So this is for counseling. I have other things like if you want to join an NGO, want to volunteer with me. You don't have to. I don't charge and all for these. You can just join. It's an NGO. It's a beautiful experience, which gives you a platform basically to reach out. YouTube communities, so you can connect with me on a more personal level. Basically Patreon. So once you open this, you directly come to the Patreon page. So do have a look at this, guys, and tell me if you like my website. I've made it on my own. So I was quite excited to share it with you guys. Whoever's watching this video are the first people who'll be seeing my website. So I hope you enjoyed the lecture, and I'll be posting all the lectures soon. Take care and thank you.